Good evening and welcome. As Dean of Georgetown University's McDonough School of Business, I'm pleased to welcome you to our Stanton Distinguished Leaders Series this evening, featuring Arne Sorenson, President and Chief Executive Officer at Marriott International. Each semester, the Stanton Series brings accomplished executives to campus to share their leadership insights with the Georgetown community. These interactions are a key part of our mission to educate students to be globally minded, principled leaders who are in service to business and society. Those may sound like abstract concepts, but looking at the culture at Marriott International can show how they each lead to successful business practices. Understanding the global economy is key to an industry like hospitality. Marriott would not be the global brand it is today, with more than 4,300 hotels in 85 countries and territories, without adapting to different business norms and cultures around the world. If you know the history of Marriott, you've heard stories of how since its founding, the Marriott family has emphasized a culture that supports its associates first and foremost, with the belief that if you take care of associates, they'll take care of your customers, and the customers will come back again and again. And by embracing principal leadership, the company is one of only a dozen to appear on Fortune's Best Companies to Work For list for all 18 years of its existence. Finally, Marriott's business model is rooted in service to business and society. They're committed to supporting human rights, environmental issues, workforce development, and more. In fact, Arne Sorenson co-founded Marriott's Global Sustainability Council in 2007, and in 2008, he launched Marriott's Rainforest Preservation Partnership with the Amazon Sustainable Foundation in Brazil. It's important to us to invite leaders like Arne Sorenson to speak with you to show how the values of your Georgetown education can be impactful wherever life beyond the hilltop takes you. Before becoming president and CEO of Marriott, Arne was Marriott's president and chief operating officer. He is chairman of Marriott's Global Diversity and Inclusion Council and on Marriott's Board of Directors Committee for Excellence, a board subcommittee focused on diversity. He serves as vice chair of the President's Export Council, the Luther College Board of Regents, and the Board of Trustees for the Brookings Institution. Arne is active in many other ways as a civic leader. Prior to joining Marriott in 1996, he was a partner with the law firm Latham & Watkins in Washington, D.C., where he specialized in mergers and acquisitions litigation. He's a graduate of the University of Minnesota Law School and Luther College in Decorah, Iowa. He and his wife, Ruth, are also Georgetown parents. Their daughter, Esther, graduated from the college in 2011. Moderating tonight's event is Jeff Mocker, a professor of strategy, economics, and public policy at the McDonough School of Business. He is the academic director of our Center for Business and Public Policy, and his research focuses on the interaction of strategy, economics, and innovation. Please join me in welcoming Jeff and Arne for tonight's conversation.
So now I'm on. Good. Thank you, Dean Thomas, for that wonderful introduction. So before we begin, I think it's appropriate to start with full disclosure. I've known Arne for a number of years. We live about a block away from each other. One of his best friends is actually my next door neighbor, so I see Arne pretty frequently. Arne's youngest son used to babysit my kids, so it's a little bit incestuous. Nevertheless, some interesting facts about Arne. He's one of the nicest individuals you'll ever meet, but he pales in comparison to his wife, who is probably the most wonderful person I've ever met. Also, what's interesting about Arne is when he's sick, he prefers a certain type of food. And what is that food?
A sushi.
So why is that?
Well, my roots are from the Midwest, of course, but my parents were Lutheran missionaries in Japan for 13 years, and I was born in Tokyo. I lived there until I was seven. And even when we came back to the United States, Japanese cuisine was our comfort food. So on Thanksgiving or Christmas, we would not necessarily have a turkey, but we'd have sukiyaki. My mother would do donburis on Saturday for lunch. We didn't have a lot of money growing up, so sushi was not that available in the 60s and 70s, really. Now it's everywhere, right? You get it at the grocery store.
Yeah.
But it still is the food that we go back to for our comfort food.
That's great. And also, I should preface, where I want to take this discussion today is just a little bit about Arne's background and history, and then talk about some of the hotel industry changes and also industry competition. Eventually, a little bit about Marriott, and then the most recent announcement of the Starwood acquisition. So you spent 12 years as an antitrust lawyer. And then I understand Marriott came courting, but you were somewhat hesitant. Why were you sort of thinking about whether you wanted to do this or not?
Well, I went to Luther College, as the dean mentioned, which is a small liberal arts college in northeast Iowa. My father had gone there, and both of my grandfathers had gone there. They all became Lutheran preachers. I didn't. And so I was finishing college and thinking, what do I do? And decided I might as well go to law school. I'd never met a lawyer, or never really spent time with somebody I knew to be a lawyer. But I thought it was a place I could get training to do a number of different things. And I ended up graduating from law school, had a great time to get work, and ultimately ended up here at Washington at Latham & Watkins. Sort of towards the tail end of my time practicing law, I represented Marriott in a very controversial transaction. I don't know whether it's taught here at Georgetown Business School at all, but there are still courses taught in business school that include the Marriott case, because what we did was we again, I wasn't there at the time, but advised the company. They left the debt and the real estate in the surviving company and spun off essentially all the operating businesses to a new company, which is Marriott International, the company I'm CEO of. And not surprisingly, the debt holders of the surviving company, bondholders, sued and complained mightily because their credit was worse. And that became a SEC investigation. We had a jury trial in federal court in Baltimore. We had proceedings in Delaware about lots of arcane financial issues. But I got to know Mr. Marriott and other leaders at the company in the process of that very sort of searing transaction. And then a few years later, he said, why don't you come out? And I thought, why not?
But you were not coming out in a lawyer capacity. You wanted to switch your...
There was no reason to go out to continue practice law. I was a partner of a great law firm, and if they needed a lawyer, they could hire me.
Okay.
And so it was a question of doing something different. But there was no definition to it. Mr. Marriott, I knew reasonably well, but not as a friend necessarily, instead somebody who was running the company. And I think somewhat foolishly, I said okay without any definition around it at all. Now, it turned out okay, but it wasn't necessarily what was predicted.
Yeah. What's interesting, too, about Marriott, for the students that don't know this, it's a company founded in 1927. In its history, it's had three CEOs. The first CEO, Jay Willard, served 45 years. The second CEO served 40 years. Do you have 40 years in you?
I doubt it. No.
All right.
I've made 3.5.
Right, he's at 3.5, so you only have 36 and a half more to go. But I think also interesting is you're the first non-Marriott CEO, and can you describe what that is, what your relationship is with the Marriott family? Are they involved?
Bill Marriott, the last CEO, is still our chairman of the board. I had lunch with him today. He's 83, but he is incredibly interested in the business. Again, he was CEO for 40 years. He actually worked for 15 or 20 before becoming CEO. So his tenure with the company is extraordinary in its length. And he remains very curious about the business and quite interested. So the family is still a prominent part of our business. They own about 25% of the stock of the company. And they're, in a sense, they are not only people we know, but they broadly humanize the company. So you think about, we have maybe 300,000, 350,000 people who wear our name badge every day, all around the world.
Yeah.
For them to be able to associate the company with a family is a really powerful, powerful thing, because it sort of breaks the company down, and it doesn't become impersonal the way many big companies can become.
Okay. And obviously, as CEO of a 4,300 properties, you have to do a lot of travel. About how many days a week, days a year are you gone? And then how many properties do you actually get to visit?
So I'm probably gone close to 200 nights a year. I deliberately don't count because I'm not sure I want to know. I am blessed with a wonderful wife and partner at home who has never given me a hard time for the amount I work, because she has a life and we have four kids and we love each other very much, but there's plenty to keep her occupied. But I'm out all very, very frequently. I probably tour in a detailed way, 300 of our hotels 300. A year, and maybe another 100 or 150 competitor hotels a year.
Okay.
some number like that.
Foam or feather pillows?
Feather.
That's a standard Marriott question when you join the rewards.
Yeah. Now I could go on way too long about little arcane details of our business, but just to give you a sense, in many respects, business today runs in the political environment. And so every social issue that you can imagine is raised with us by one of our customers, including feather pillows.
Feather versus foam.
And so we've had protesters at annual meetings that say you should never provide a feather pillow in any guest room because of the way feathers are harvested. And of course, we do our best to make sure we're getting feathers from responsible places. But we have millions of customers who really want feather pillows.
I would imagine. So let's switch gears and talk a little bit about the recent changes in the industry. I would be remiss from the students in the room if I didn't ask about Airbnb. In particular, you've gone on record as to how you think their model's evolving, and I'd love it if you went through that. But how big do you think they'll get? How relevant do you think they'll get as a competitor to you, and how will you respond?
Yeah. How many people here have used Airbnb? Looks like a third, maybe something like that, quarter to a third, which is I think an indication of how big they already are. And I think they're going to be a factor going forward. I think the first phase of Airbnb is classic sharing economy.
Yeah.
And in a sense, that is the part of their business which is most threatening, because it's quite distinct, right? You can have a very local experience where you stay in someone's home. Maybe it's their extra bedroom. Maybe it's the whole home. But you get an experience which is very different from a big hotel, right? And a big hotel might be 50 rooms in comparison to that home, let alone we have hotels that have 2,000 rooms. Not that many of them. That's not typical, but we have a number that way. And so that's a very different experience, and I think it grew quickly in that first phase because it's a different experience, because it often delivered value. So I could maybe go and stay in New York for $100 a night, when our lowest priced hotel in New York, a Fairfield,
yeah,
on the
sure.
west side, would be $225 or something like that. And of course the hotels would go up from there. And I think thirdly, because the hosts who were able to monetize that extra bedroom really loved it as an income source.
Sure.
Their second phase, which they're starting now, is in some respects a little bit less threatening, because they are now often engaging with somebody who's in effect running a micro hotel, taking six dedicated apartments in a new build apartment
right.
building. And nobody lives in those apartments, but they're available in Airbnb every night. And whoever is probably leased those from somebody to then re-let on Airbnb is arranging cleaning and doing other things. Well, then that becomes actually not that different a product. Then it's a competition about location and price,
mm-hmm.
And that's the competition we've been in for a long, long time.
And you welcome it?
Well, we welcome it, yeah. Obviously, we'd like to have no competitors.
Sure, of course.
We can't quite have that world. So that competition, I think, we'll do well with.
But so long as they have to pay the same sort of occupancy taxes and local and state taxes that you do, I think.
As long as the playing field is level. Now, my own view, excuse me, is if you're really in the classic shared economy, so if it's your extra bedroom in the,
yeah,
in the basement, right?
You shouldn't.
I think the authorities could have sort of a sense of humor about if you do that for a few weeks,
yeah,
a year, do you really need to get hyper-regulated about it? Probably not. But when you get into a place where somebody is dedicating units, clearly you've got to pay taxes, and clearly requirements around accessible units, around sprinklers and life safety features, that playing field ought to be leveled.
Okay. Let me ask you another question on one of the things I think that we're seeing in terms of technological change is the online travel agent versus the direct booking that you now offer. Can you compare and contrast those in terms of sort of how you view OTAs versus direct booking?
Yeah, so the OTAs or online travel agents, Expedia and Priceline would be the ones that are known best here. But you see others around the world. Rakuten in Japan is a very very prominent site. You've got in China, Alibaba is getting into this space significantly. And unlike Airbnb, for example, these are sort of earlier disruptors, yeah. But they don't sell their own product. They sit as middlemen, technology middlemen, essentially, between a hotel and a hotel guest. And obviously, they want to grow their business and make as many reservations as they can and charge as big a commission to us as they possibly can. But they're still selling our product for the same price. And so we end up in this sort of frenemies relationship with them, where they're delivering folks who travel little, maybe once a year, who don't really know hotel brands, who probably don't travel enough to care about points and other things. Those customers can be incremental to us, and that's good business that we'd love to have. But to the extent they try and get Dean Thomas, who travels, I'm guessing, 45 nights a year, 60 nights a year, something like that, who knows hotels and would stay with us anyway, I'd much rather he book with us directly than cost us, between 10 and 15% of the total revenue for the commission. And so we end up with this relationship where we say, okay, we've got to make sure we deliver more value to the folks who book with us directly to give them a real economic incentive. And that's in the first instance points, which you don't get if you book through an OTA. But it will also be things like free Wi-Fi, late checkout, maybe a longer shorter cancellation window. In other words, you can cancel without penalty closer to your stay, those sorts of things.
So one of the things I think that you just mentioned is interesting for one of our professors here, Rebecca Hamilton. She's interested in amenity creep.
Right.
Has that become problematic? Amenity, free Wi-Fi, free breakfasts, later checkout. Yep. Has that become problematic? And can you actually measure the return on investment of offering additional amenities? Or have you attempted to do that?
Well, yes and no. I mean, I think amenity creep is a sounds like a phrase that industry, because that's a phrase we use in our industry. But if you stand back from our industry and think about the way we as consumers have evolved over generations, we're just more demanding.
Yeah.
And it's not just about the shampoo or the Wi-Fi. It's about the quality of the bed we sleep in, it's about the quality of the food we eat, it's about the interest in the design. I barely stayed in hotels growing up, but in the early parts of my professional life, I didn't really think all that much about an experience which turned me on when I stayed in a hotel. And today, you're disappointed if you don't find something that's interesting there. So it's not just the amenities, it's the hotels need to be better. They need to be delivering experiences that cause people to remember where they stayed, to enjoy it, to get pleasure. And you, all you young people here are going to be much more demanding than I ever was. Is that amenity creep? Maybe in some respect, but I think it's even bigger than that.
We call them whiners, but separate issue. One other thing, at least from the industry changes that are occurring, what I've been reading from the investment bankers is the following. There's been a decrease in demand growth and a subsequent increase in supply growth, and a question of whether the industry is hitting a mature stage. Do you feel that the industry is beginning? RevPAR numbers are slowing down. That's revenue per available room are beginning to slow down in terms of their growth. So is there any pause or concern you have for the industry overall? Not necessarily to Marriott.
Yeah. No, we're always paying attention to the economic cycle. The industry has never had a supply-induced turndown. Think about demand being driven by the economy broadly, GDP growth being the simplest correlation. If GDP is growing, demand for hotel rooms is growing, demand for travel is growing. Business travelers,
right.
meetings, and a vacation. And so the first question you've got to think about when you ask questions about, all right, is demand slowing? Are you worried about where we are in the cycle? Is what do you think about GDP? My personal view is we've had modest GDP growth since 2010 when we started coming out of the recession. More modest than out of any other recovery.
Yeah.
No real surprise to that. We know what the reasons are for it. That growth in the 2.5% US GDP growth range is sort of what we'd expect for next year and maybe for a few years after that. Now, will it in fact come? Who knows? The supply story is the only variable, which is an industry-specific one. And we know that with each year of positive RevPAR growth, more and more new hotel projects start. It's the nature of the cycle.
Yeah.
But we're still nowhere near the supply growth we've seen in coming out of prior cycles.
Okay.
And so we think demand is likely to grow faster than supply. We should be fine.
So let's jump on supply. It seems that those platforms with more rooms and more locations at more price points, i.e. the number of different brands, tend to be viewed better as those. Is it a scale and scope business in your mind?
Well, there are parts of that. I mean, the rewards programs, they are more powerful for regular travelers the bigger they are. So if we allow you to earn points with us no matter where you're traveling and no matter what the purpose of your trip is. So if you want to stay in a Ritz-Carlton because your father's paying for the bill or because it's a special occasion, or you stay somewhere else at Fairfield when sometime you're trying to save money. If we can earn points and all those things, that's a really good thing. I think secondly, and one of the fundamental shifts in the business is partly driven by OTAs and Airbnb, but we live in a technology world and we spend hundreds of millions of dollars a year on technology. The bigger you are, the more those resources can be invested in technology. And to try and have your own website is one thing, but to have a loyalty program, to have the ability to do personalized marketing, to be able to have the apps that one day will allow us all to open our hotel room doors, to market to folks when they're in the hotels, all of those things are extraordinarily expensive. And in a sense, on this, you know, frenemies with the OTAs, we want to make sure that our ecosystem is as compelling as it can be so that our customers find our app to be worth using.
So an interesting consulting project I just read from Deloitte & Touche indicates that about the average hotel loyalty member has about three hotels that they're actually using. How do you get them to tip to Marriott versus Hilton or something else? What do you have to do to make them move from using three separate hotel loyalty programs to using just one?
I should talk about people first, just to make sure we do it. I mean, clearly you need to deliver a good experience, and that means both the quality of the product that is being stayed in, as well as the service experience. And I think in part because of our history of taking care of our folks, we do deliver a good service experience generally. It's not perfect always, and we're constantly measuring and trying to make sure we continue to improve. And hopefully we'll continue to drive some performance there. But then you get to the points programs by themselves. The hardcore travelers, so the folks who leave here and go to work for McKinsey or one of the consulting shops or for one of the accounting firms, who make my travel look light. And maybe some of you are already working in these shops, but often they'll start and they'll get a memo from somebody who's there that explains to them exactly what their internal analysis is about which programs deliver the most value and at what stage you try and book more with one or then spread your bet and go to some others.
Yeah.
And so there are, there are internal analysis that's all being done. And we try and keep up with that analysis so we make sure that their internal work always says Marriott Rewards is where you ought to go.
Well, one of the things that's interesting, a recent Wall Street Journal article, I believe in November, indicated that you have the best payback of any of the hotel programs out there. For every $100 that you spend at Marriott, it returns about $9.40. The next highest is Hilton at 8.9. So what that means is free Wi-Fi, the ability to use rewards for free vacations and whatnot. So it tends to be pretty beneficial from that perspective. One other thing I want to talk about in terms of industry trends are tie-ins. You mentioned downstairs with Dean Thomas and myself how much the Chase Visa card has done for the business. But the other one I want you to mention is Rewards Plus. So as most of my students, and how many students do I have here that I've had before? Most of my students know I'm Premier 1K, and I only fly United Airlines.
Yeah.
I don't even look at other airlines. Now Marriott signed an exclusive agreement with United for their gold members, and that has completely turned me to Marriott. I stay in no other hotel.
Yeah.
In fact, I got my Marriott Visa card about 2 years ago. So you had me at hello. soon as you did that. But now I have Gold Elite status at Marriott along with 1K, 20 or 10. 10. So how have those two done?
They've done well. I mean, I think the just your United stories where you started shows this, that the best way to get value from any of these programs, whether they're airline or hotel programs, is to deliver them value. Because the more value they deliver, the more you start to get bonus miles, or you get bonus points, or you get two times. I mean, I'm a global services on United.
You're global service. So that means that's not miles he flies, that's dollars he spends on United.
The best story on global services, I was flying from the Middle East once back to Washington on a Friday night and connecting through Frankfurt. And I was even farther, I was in the stands and connecting through Frankfurt. Flight was late. We landed in Frankfurt, and it was doubtful whether I'd make the connection back. And I think my kids were still at home. Somebody had a school play or something at Somerset, I don't remember. And so I was a little stressed out. They opened the door. There was somebody standing at the top of the stairway with my name on it. And they had a car at the bottom, and they drove me to the stairway of the plane leaving for Washington.
Yeah.
Put me on that plane. That's what global services gets you.
It's good. it's good to be the king.
But again, the more volume, then the more you're going to get back.
Yeah.
It's easy.
Yeah. I did 40 nights at Marriott this year.
Fabulous.
No, for you. That's good. none for me. It was terrible. I was gone 40 days. All right, so for those of you that don't know, I'm going to say this really quickly. Marriott founded in 1927. It was actually a 9-stool root beer stand. It moved to a restaurant chain and then finally to what it is today. 4,300 properties, 1 million rooms in 80 countries, 350,000 employees, 2,500 of those headquartered in Bethesda, and 19 brands. The model, though, is actually pretty simple. So do you want to talk about your business model in sort of two dimensions, an asset light and then RevPAR growth, unit growth, and share buybacks?
Yeah, we're running two businesses, really. One business is the one that we've been talking about, and the one you first think about, which is who stays in our hotels, who eats in our hotels. Those are the customers you think about in the first instance. But we have another business, which is serving folks who own hotels, who are real estate investors. So 4,200 hotels. Today we own 6 of them, maybe.
Yeah.
And those are for sale. There's one historical accident or another that causes us to own those 6. Last year, 2014, we signed 100,000 new hotel rooms to come into our system. That was about 650 hotels. Each one of those hotels was a deal with a real estate investor.
Wow.
And so we've got to service them so that they decide to pick our brands as opposed to one of our competitors' brands. And that is through good things about a relationship, but it's also fundamentally about delivering profitable returns for their real estate investment. And so we do that, and we charge them for our services. We charge a percentage of the top line. And for hotels we manage, we charge a percentage of the profits of the hotel as well. And so we're in a fee-earning business, and we push them. Now, in terms of our one other point on our business model, very simple on some level. Beneath it, it's very complicated, but we need to run the existing hotels we have well. And so we look at revenue per available room, RevPAR, and we look at RevPAR index. How well are we performing compared to the hotels we compete against in each market? and what are the things we can do to drive that performance, which of course drives the fees that we get from those hotels. The second is unit growth, also a top-line revenue driver for us. We're growing today at 6 or 7% net new units compared to the base. Mm-hmm. The third is expense control, managing our overhead. So the more we do that, we can take those first two levers, drop it right down to the bottom line, and then we produce a lot of cash flow. And we use the cash flow usually to buy back our stock.
But I would also, I guess, add the incentive fee management. And maybe you're including that in the cost.
That's the profit share. Yeah.
And what's amazing is the company's maintained earning per share growth of about 20% ever since you've been. And I failed to mention this. The stock has doubled since you became CEO.
Yeah, this year has not been quite as good. But
let's ignore that for now. So in the brief minutes that I have, I want to talk about the Starwood acquisition. Folks, this was just announced on November 16th. I listened to the podcast of B of A, and you kind of intimated that, we might do another acquisition. And this podcast was in late September. $12.2 billion acquisition, financed mainly with stock, expected to be accretive in the second year. The largest hotel firm in the world with 5,500 hotels and more than 1.1 million properties. Talk briefly about the benefits that you see on both the revenue side and the cost side for this acquisition.
So Starwood has, W Hotels is one of the brands that is best known, even though it's only about 50 hotels today. But they also own St. Regis, Westin, Sheraton, and a loft. Now they're through Le Meridian, there are a few other brands as well. They are a bit more global than we are. About half of their hotels are outside the U.S. Ours is about 25% outside the U.S. And they've got in the SPG program a pretty powerful loyalty program. Yeah. I think Marriott Rewards and SPG are the two strongest programs out there. And so we looked at this. This deal came together in 3 weeks. So at the B of A conference, I was not thinking we would acquire Starwood.
Really?
Our first look at it, it was more expensive where the stocks were trading at the time. And the big riddle, which we can talk about, is Sheraton, which is a big brand that needs some re-energizing in the United States. And so we passed. And then we got into late October, and the stocks had shifted so that the economic aspects of the transaction were much better. And by that point in time, I had spent much of the last few months meeting with Facebook and Google and Expedia and Alibaba and all sorts of these folks in the technology space, and became more and more convinced that long term, there are enormous advantages to being bigger. So we sort of dusted off our earlier efforts to look at it. I called their chairman of the board on one Friday night and said, we may be too late. And you may not like the idea that I'm going to throw on the table right now. If you don't, let's not waste time. But how about we do a simple stock merger, essentially an even-up deal. And by the next day, they said, we're interested. You're late. You've got to move quickly. And so 3 weeks and 2 days later, we announced the deal.
Can I ask you a couple questions on what the analysts have said in both pros and cons? Most of the analysts agree that the terms are favorable to Marriott. You underpaid, potentially. And they've also suggested that there weren't many bidders. I don't know if you want to agree with that or not. Most have agreed that the $200 million in cost savings, the synergies that you'll achieve, is low. They actually expect more from that. Most have agreed that it'll help your bargaining power with some of your hotel operators, the owners, the hotel owners. Some think it's a good strategy because it drives your international growth, as you mentioned, and pushes you up into the luxury market. So that seems to be good.
Yep.
But others, and these are the ones I want your opinions on, are worried about how quickly you can sell off some of the Starwood properties that they own. So remember, this is an asset-light model. They don't own the hotels, but Starwood does own a lot of their hotels. That's one. Some have concerns about the brand overlap. And they're wondering if divestitures of specific brands, in particular Sheraton, which is on a RevPAR basis about 10 to 12 points below what the average Marriott hotel is. So it's really underperforming. Thoughts on those concerns?
Yeah, I think the biggest question is distraction, because to do a $12 or $13 billion merger of two operating companies is a lot of work.
Yeah.
And that's the thing I worry about more than anything else. I think the second thing would be questions around Sheraton. But go back to the business model for a second. Remember that each one of these hotels is owned by somebody else. in our system. Starwood owns a few more hotels than we do, but still they own a significant minority of their hotels. So overwhelmingly, you've got third parties who own these hotels. The day we were really starting the diligence process, we were having our hotel owners conference in Miami. And I, at the cocktail party that night, I was talking to a couple of our hotel owners. And one of them came up to me and said, I hear Starwood's going to be bought by, named a Chinese company. What are you hearing? I said, well, they don't tell me anything. And I said, who do you think should buy it? He said, well, you should buy it, and you should sell Sheraton after you buy it. Another owner in the conversation, I said, do you own any Sheratons? He said, yeah. He said, how would you feel if we called and said, well, we're buying Starwood, but we're spinning Sheraton off to, and I used a company name, which I won't use from the stage here, but a less reputable set of brands. And he said, I'd hate you for it. And I think that's that, in fact, you'd be offending a huge number of important customers.
Yeah.
And so we will not divest in any significant sense any brands, including Sheraton.
Really?
We will, though, have to work over the next few years to bring Sheraton up, and that probably means to get rid of the worst hotels.
Okay.
Sheraton is actually a much stronger global brand than it appears from the United States.
Okay.
The older, more tired hotels are in the United States, and we'll find a way to either get them improved or we'll get rid of them.
All right. One other question, I guess, on this from, again, one of my colleagues, and Dean Thomas raised this as well. Will the loyalty programs be merged?
Well, I'd like to see them ultimately merged. They are obviously, we think first about the loyal members of those programs. We have 55 million at Marriott Rewards. They have about 22 million at SPG.
Right.
There is some overlap between those two.
Yeah,
but the bigger they are, obviously better. You can save money on technology and other things by pulling them together. But we've got lots of partners. So SPG has an Amex card with American Express. Marriott Rewards has a Visa card with JP Morgan Chase. Both are very significant financial businesses in their own right to the hotel companies, but also to the credit card and finance companies. Each has a timeshare company associated with it, no longer owned by either one, or won't be.
Both have been.
But they're interested in using those programs to sell timeshare facilities. And so we need to work through those relationships in order to get to a place. I'd like to see us pull them together. You know, we got to figure out the technology too.
Okay. Do we want to take questions, or are we at that time? Okay. I was going to ask one last question, and I looked at the board. The board is made up of, it's pretty balanced actually, a number of good female representation, male representation, business representation, and Marriott family representation. I was really hopeful that there wouldn't be an academic on, and my joke would be, well, you need to put an academic on. Unfortunately, there's an academic on already. But you're also adding three more from Starwood. You're going to have a 14-member board.
Yeah.
Right. Okay, well, we'll leave it at that, and I think we want to open it up for questions.
Hi, I'm Evan, first-year MBA. Thank you for being here. So as Professor Macker mentioned, you have 5,000 locations that you're responsible for managing globally. Many of those locations are in areas of heavy political risk right now. Given the current environment, how do you weigh that risk and everything that's going on?
Yeah, those are good questions. I was in Brussels last night, and Brussels has been in the news, obviously, a lot since the events in Paris of a couple of weeks ago. Is that a high-risk market? It sort of depends on your perspective. There is risk everywhere in the world, obviously, and we do the best we can. So after the events in Paris, we elevated our security protocols across Europe. When you go to the two markets in the Middle East, the security protocols have always been higher. So in a number of markets, we would not let anybody in without first inspecting the cars, having dogs, as well as having spectrometers who are looking at bags and looking at other things that come into the hotels. But there are, you know, there are lines here. A few years ago, we had a project in our development pipeline in Afghanistan, in Kabul, which I killed. I killed after the intercon had been bombed about 3 years ago, if I remember right. Because I couldn't imagine having any of our people go in and try and run a hotel in that environment. And so do you get those lines always right? And of course, it's difficult once you've opened a hotel to ever close. Our shortest ever life of a hotel was in Tripoli. We opened a JW Marriott in Tripoli and closed it when that war, I guess we should call it, started about 3 weeks after we opened it. It's still not reopened. I don't know whether it'll ever reopen. Libya is essentially a lawless place today. And so you sort of work it through and do the best you possibly can with cooperation with law enforcement, local law enforcement, and having security in place.
Hi, thank you for being here. I'm CJ, second year MBA. So we recently did an analysis on Marriott's balance sheet, and we thought you actually disclosed as shareholders' deficit because of your large amount of stock repurchase. And why do you guys like say those stock in treasury stock? Why not cancel it?
Well, you've got a couple of things going on there. One is whether you treat it as treasury stock or not, and the second is what does your shareholders' equity account look like from an accounting perspective? Every few years, some analyst puts out a report that says, watch out for Marriott, they're dramatically over-levered, because if you look at their debt against their shareholders' equity, it looks awful. Well, that's because our shareholders' equity is $3 or $4 billion negative, I think, at this point. I don't remember precisely, because it's not relevant. It has zero relevance to the assessment of Marriott. Now, I shouldn't say that in a business school, because there are undoubtedly finance professors here who will disagree with me. But our approach is, when we have extra capital that does not need to be invested in our business, we're going to return it to our shareholders. And every share that we buy back at market prices is a straight deduct from our shareholders' equity account. So we're now negative, and it's going to go more negative in the years. Now, if we do this merger, obviously, it'll change that. But we'll get back to a place where we continue to drive that number more and more negative.
Hi, I'm Antonia. I'm a sophomore in the business school. My question is, what do you think are the keys to successfully manage and lead a huge number of employees, especially in terms of implementing the company values and culture?
Fundamental question, and a really important one. I think there are lots of different pieces to this. By the way, I think people can be successful leaders with very different personalities. So if you study leadership, you need to be really careful about assessing the voice that you're hearing, because often that voice will say, because maybe not in words, but subconsciously will say, because this is my personality, this is therefore the best way to lead. When if you have a different personality, those may not be the best tools that need to be used. So I think that's one important thing to keep in mind. I think the second is, particularly in an operating business like ours, where it's people intensive and we're in lots of different cultures, we have to distribute more and more authority away from the center. So one of the main tools of, I think, successfully leading a company like Marriott is empowering people all around the globe, including people in hotels, general managers, executive committees, and all the people in the hotels, but also the folks who are overseeing hotels in Europe or the Middle East or Asia. And so we've built a leadership team that includes empowered teams in Hong Kong and Dubai and in London and in Miami for Latin America, who have the ability to run that business on a day-to-day basis and do not have to come out for approval all the time. So that empowerment, I think, is also a really important piece. I think the other thing empowerment does is it creates teamwork. And if it can be done in a way that is also collaborative, so people feel like they're involved in the creation process, co-creating, even bring your customers in. But when you talk first about just the leadership team, the more people feel like they're involved and that they are empowered to make decisions and make mistakes, that the decisions and the opinions they have are valued, the more engaged they'll be in their work, and therefore the bigger contribution you get. And that makes my job easier, the less I have to do. We would fail, and I think actually any big company would fail, if it was totally dependent on one person or even the group of, you know, 5 to 10 senior people in a company to come up with all the ideas. The world is moving too fast, and it's way too complicated for that to succeed.
Hi,
In the interim, let me ask another question I failed to ask before on consolidation. Steve Joyce just came out and indicated that he expects the industry to consolidate, both because of the importance of scale as well as the potential threat from Airbnb. Do you see substantial consolidation? It often happens in industries that there's an effect on everyone to merge once one merger has happened. For instance, in airlines, in cellular telephony, the same things have happened. Do you expect more mergers over the next several years?
It's funny, if you had asked this question roughly 5 weeks ago,
say no.
I would have said I don't expect any significant mergers, because this is unprecedented space, actually. Portfolios of brands have never been put together before. We're now doing this deal. Of course, we're believers that we can create great value here. And I think it's causing other voices in the industry to say, all right, Marriott, Starwood are doing it. There's going to be a wave of consolidation. There are advantages, as we've talked about, to being bigger. And so to the extent those deals can be made to happen, you should expect more of them. On the other hand, Starwood was for sale. Starwood had started a process 7 or 8 months ago. They had a bunch of internal dynamics that made them right for sale, and the board formally put them out for sale. It's relatively easy to do a deal in those circumstances. When companies are not for sale, then they're run by somebody who doesn't want to lose their job, mergers are much less likely to occur.
Yeah, okay. I think we have another question.
Hi, my name is Esther Shin, second year MBA. I would like to know that I think you explained a lot of about like the business perspective, but I would like to know, when you have like a lot of like things going on, you know, you have a lot going on, you're traveling a lot, obviously, and you have a lot on your shoulder. How do you keep yourself motivated apart from loving your job?
Loving the job is a big part of it. I've never lacked for motivation. I love my work. I'm turned on by it. It's hard to turn it off. Actually, more than anything else. And this doesn't really quite respond to you, but I see Jeff more often than not. I'll see him when he's out running in the neighborhood at some ungodly early hour. He's usually finishing his run by the time I get out to go. But exercise is a really important thing. And I'm most committed to exercise and travel. I leave here Saturday morning for Shanghai. I'll get into Shanghai Sunday evening. I'll go straight to the fitness center, and I will have one of the most intense workouts. But then every day when I'm in Asia, I'll be in the gym. And I'll make sure the team has scheduled an hour or, you know, hopefully a little bit longer than that. An hour is tight to get a shower and do the rest of it, but to get time for that exercise, because that is, I think, essential. And, you know, this will sound maybe corny on some level, but I think having somebody that you love and is partnered in life with you is a really important thing. That doesn't necessarily mean traditional marriage, but I think it to be not alone is a powerful thing. There's a hand over here.
Yeah. Oh, you want me to go first? Sorry. Hi, Karthik Sundaraman. So my question to you is a little bit personal. Can you tell me some of your challenges or something? Because you actually kind of switched careers kind of midway. You were a full-time lawyer or something, and then you moved to becoming more like managing Marriott. So some of the initial challenges or something, could you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, my younger brother would say I'm too foolish to worry about the things I don't know. And so I haven't tortured myself with the things I don't know. Now, the most striking time in my career, I had gotten to Marriott. The first 2 years at Marriott, I did M&A. And while I had been a lawyer and a litigator, no less, I was involved in merger transactions, usually contested deals that had gone south or were, you know, there were lawsuits, et cetera. And so the M&A space was a fairly familiar terrain, even though I was doing it from the business side. I got this sort of mysterious call from Mr. Marriott. I was traveling, of course, but the office said he wants you to show up at his house on Saturday morning. And We had just bought a place on the Eastern Shore, and I drove off Saturday morning. My wife said, "I hope you're not going to get fired." And I had no idea what it was about. So I show up, and he brings me into his library and says, "Our CFO is leaving. I want you to be the CFO." Now, I'm a lawyer. Undergrad, I was a religion major. I didn't go to a great business school like Georgetown. And I said, "Are you nuts? I don't know what you're talking about." And he said, "You got a chief accounting officer, you've got a treasurer, you've got a team of extraordinary people. I need you to really come in and make sure that we're making the right strategic decisions." And defined that way, it was a very liberating sort of idea. Now, I'm not sure that could be done today. When you think about the Sarbanes-Oxley world we live mm-hmm. in, you think about the conservatism of boards who are going to say, "All right, well, didn't he at least go to Georgetown Business School? Maybe he's a finance major, not an accounting major, but you know, at least you can have somebody who's got some pedigree, right, that we can look at and say, all right, we can check that box, we feel good about it." I didn't have any of those things, and I'm not sure you could do that today. But I loved it. I mean, from the first day, I thought it was a fabulous job, and again, defined that way, it's a great thing. I do think one of the advantages of a global company, a company like Marriott, which has a real ease of accessibility, Jeff and I were talking before, once you stay in a hotel, you think you know something about the business, and that's a wonderful thing, because people want to talk about it, and they're connected to it, and they're passionate about it. But it's also got lots and lots of arcane pieces. Think about the real estate development business that we're in. You think about technology investing. You think about managing all around the world and trying to do those in the right places. So you're constantly learning. And I think that's a great thing. And I wouldn't for a second ever think that I don't have a ton more to learn. And every day, hopefully, we do some of that.
One more question? No. Yeah. Okay, all right.
So hi, my name is Lindsay, and I'm currently a freshman in the business school. Again, thank you so much for being here today. I know they mentioned earlier that only 25% of Marriott's hotels are outside the United States, and I was wondering why that is and what Marriott's general plans for international development will be in the next 10 or 20 years.
So our first hotel opened outside the United States about 35 years ago, and the initial plan, I think, was to open hotels in markets where Americans traveled. And so Amsterdam, Hong Kong was very early, Cairo was early, a big vacation destination. These were places that we could open a hotel and have high confidence that we could fill them with American travelers. And so our first phase was really simply doing that. And I think we did that for a number of years. We didn't really focus that much on international growth. I think today we are very focused on it. Of our pipeline of hotels yet to open, which is about 260,000 rooms, maybe 140,000 of those, so 45% or so, are outside the United States. So we're growing faster outside the United States. And our business today is no longer about serving Americans. So think about China, we're opening a hotel every 2 weeks. We have probably 75 hotels open, maybe 25 in the city of Shanghai alone. And in those markets, the majority of business in every one of those hotels, including Shanghai, are Chinese travelers. So we need a Chinese leadership team, we need Chinese food, of course, language, all the rest of it, but we really need to run a Chinese business in China. And the same can be said for most markets around the world. And that means, you know, getting the brand strategy right, it means getting the leadership right, and it means finding the right kind of real estate development business. That's easier in a place like China, where you've got an economy that's growing very quickly, plenty of capital. It's much harder in other parts of the world where there are not transparent real estate markets, where there's not a lot of capital, maybe period. And so if you've got to find some foreign investor to come in, foreign to that market, that may be a very, very difficult thing to do.
And I also think the Starwood acquisition is going to help you
push further
in international. If I remember, it takes you to 100 countries? Or is
it'll be about, I haven't actually done the count, but it'll be over 100, I'm sure.
Yeah, so you move from about 80 to 100 countries of operation, which is impressive.
Yeah,
my name's Tim. I'm a senior in the business school. I just was wondering, with the Starwood acquisition, what plans do you have to improve certain amount of those certain brands that they have now? And are you concerned that if you change those brands, you lose some of those loyal customers?
Yeah, those are both good questions. The on one level, this deal is available to us because Starwood has not done well growing. That second lever, the unit growth lever, in the last 5 years. And I think mostly that was because of focus. A little bit it was because of their brand lineup. So you look at their brand lineup compared to ours. While they have a Loft, which is a lifestyle version of Courtyard, which we have, they didn't really have any brands in this space beneath the full service hotels, which is where we get a lot of our unit growth. Mm-hmm. And they also sort of wrote off the United States and Europe as old world economies, putting all of their eggs in the Asian basket, particularly China. They did well in China. And because of that, the relative values of the company have shifted significantly over the last few years, putting us in a position where we could do this deal. We will bring focus to growth of their brands as well as our brands. And I think we'll see that we can grow most of those brands at a meaningfully higher pace. And that by itself is hugely strengthening to each of those brands. There is nothing like adding new flagship hotels to a brand to get marketing, to get product halo, to get, you know, a real momentum in the brand. So that's going to be, I think, a key piece of it. But then I think beyond that, by brand, we'll have to look through and understand. I talked about Sheraton a little bit. I think we'll have to find a way to make sure that we have a long-term enough focus to get rid of some hotels that can't be fixed, which will help that. And you know, for other brands, the challenge will be much less significant. I think a lot of these brands are quite strong. How do we make sure we keep the customers as back to these loyalty programs? There's a strong debate now by the SPG members. Those are their loyalists. Mm-hmm. What's Marriott going to do with our points? What's Marriott going to do with our special benefits? I've done a LinkedIn blog where I talked about this a little bit. I did a video that was posted on social media where I talked about this a little bit. And they won't be fully confident until we definitively act, which will be something that occurs over the next year or two. But for the reasons I talked about before, we're doing this deal in part because we need this stronger ecosystem of loyal customers. The last thing we're going to think about doing is harming that relationship and actually weakening that ecosystem.
We're done.
Have I exhausted you?
Okay. All right. Well, if everyone would thank me very and thank Arne, not thank me. Thank Arne for being here.
Thanks very much. Thank you.
Thank you. That was fun. Yeah, that was good.